Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of Gemology for Schmucks. My name is Peter Nelson. I'm here to guide you in everything you need to know about gemstones. Now, in many of my previous episodes, I have said, do not leave home without a loop. And today, what I would like to do is tell you and show you why that is and one of many things that you can do with a loop. After all, what is it that we are looking for when we use the loop? We're looking for, you know, stuff. So one of the many things that I do as a gemologist is that I take antique mounts, or mounts that have not been used previously, and I source colored gemstones for them. Those stones need to fit, they need to be attractive, and they need to be in a certain budget range for my client. So with my client, I first discuss what types of stones they might look for, and also how much they're hoping to spend. And once we've settled out the budget, then I can get a clearer idea of what stones I should go around looking for. So for this mounting, it's a nice 18 karat white gold mounting. And because it is such a high caratage of gold, that's a high purity of gold, I know that we can go for a higher quality gemstone. The budget can stretch a bit because the quality of the gold is there and people are more likely to convert that into a sale. So I decided, why not a sapphire? So my first step is to take this mounting and look at it from all the angles I can and get a clear idea of where is the seat on this stone. Where is it that the stone is going to be sitting down into? So with this particular mounting, I know that it's going to be a round cut stone. It doesn't have to be a round brilliant. There's many different types of faceting designs that could work with this, but the outline, the actual face of the stone, needs to be round. And I look at it from the side, I see that it has a reasonable amount of depth for that sort of face, so I can really choose whatever stone I want. So my next step is to go around in the market and try and find something that I find attractive. And when I do that, I'm going to start first off with my fingers, yes, like everybody else, just to get an idea of how much play of light and what's the overall color of this stone. Once I've decided that I actually like the stone and I find it attractive, then I'm going to try it in the setting. Why not? And once you've spent some time messing around with the stone to get it right in place and we've decided, yes, this does fit the mounting, then I'm going to take the stone off, clean it well with our cloth, and then I'm going to use some tweezers to make sure that I know what this stone looks like. What's the real color? Remember, the oils from our fingers, the schmutz, and other influencing features in our hand can really change the way the stone looks. So it's best to have it cleaned off and observe it using tweezers. And now we can pull out our trusty loop. So we've already decided that we like the stone, and now we need more information about the stone before we start talking about price. So what are we actually looking for when we get to the loop? One of the first things that we're looking for is evidence that the stone is natural. So I'm looking for features that tell me the stone is natural. The only way you're going to know that is if you study about the stone. And then you look at a lot of stones that you know are natural. This is one of the fundamental things that you study in gemology. So in this stone, when I look at it, I notice that there are many bands of color, which can happen in natural and synthetic stones both. But one key difference is that stones that are synthetic origin, that's simulated, not natural, didn't come out of the earth, if they're made with the flame fusion or pulled method, because of the way they are formed, they have these rotating, round, bent lines of growth. And typically those lines, if you can find them, are more even in size because they're made in a laboratory condition. The temperature is all the same, the speed of the pedestal moving is the same. So there's a lot of variables in that situation that are controlled, whereas in the earth, the variables get kind of crazy. So in this stone, we have straight lines and they are uneven in size, which gives me confidence that this is probably a natural stone. What are some other features that we can look for? Here, we also see that there are not only just color bands going in one direction, but we see that there are actually intersecting lines of color. And I know from studying and seeing a whole bunch of stones that this is often a natural feature that we call silk, or sometimes needles. So in many earth-mined sapphires, you will find intersecting needles, and that angle that they intersect is related to its crystal structure. Here we can see that these lines of silk, these blue fuzzy lines, intersect at something like 60 and 120 degrees, which is very typical with natural sapphires. Other things that I can see are that these needles are quite long, and that is very typical with the origin of Sri Lanka. And last but not least, I can see that these are fuzzy lines. The fuzzy blue lines give me a strong reason to believe that this stone was heat treated. And these are the types of features that we look for when using a microscope to evaluate if a stone has been heat treated or if it's completely natural. If it's completely natural, there's going to be a different set of inclusions. So really, inclusions are not bad. They give us a lot of information. Now I know that this stone is probably heat treated, probably from Sri Lanka. I'm very satisfied that it's natural and heat treated. And that gives me very powerful information now that I know I need to negotiate with this dealer over the price of this stone. I know that I can't go so low because yes, it is a natural and heat treated stone from Sri Lanka, which is an origin that oftentimes is more valuable than some of the others. Yes, we evaluate a sapphire based on its color and its clarity, as well as carat, of course, but certain origins are likely to have a certain premium associated with them. Sri Lanka is one of those. And while this has taken me a good long while to explain to you in this video, this is something that I can see in a couple of seconds with my tweezers and a loop while looking at this stone. That's the value of education. Whether you get that education in a class or just on the streets, when you build up this knowledge through time and experience, sometimes you get to pull it out and apply it, and it gives you power that you can gain in a couple of seconds of looking at a stone in person. So if you'd like to learn more about gemology and investing in gemstones, please head over to gemshepherd.com, where you can read blogs on investing, as well as gemology. And you can also contact me directly. If you've got any other questions, please leave them in the comment section below. Hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, tell all of your friends about me. And until next time, bye-bye.